We have multiple bright regions on the Earth-facing disk, including a couple big flare players, and the sun is launching solar storms left and right. Those stories and more in the news this week. This space weather forecast is sponsored in part by Millersville University. Come get certified in broadcast space weather. Visit millersville.edu/swen. Space weather this week is definitely keeping us on our toes. As we take a look at the Earth-facing sun, look at all these bright regions, both in the north and in the south. As a matter of fact, early on the 8th, wham, do you see that? That is region 2864, and it launches a partially Earth-directed solar storm that goes off to Earth's west. Now, it has given us a glancing blow, but it's not really done much but bump us up to active conditions. Meanwhile, shortly thereafter, whoosh, do you see that? That is a filament eruption, and that launches a solar storm. That one looks like it's going to go east of Earth, so we're kind of getting missed on either side. But meanwhile, we still have a lot of activity. We do even have a filament, if you can see this thing. This is crossing through the Earth strike zone right now, and if it erupts, it could launch a solar storm directed toward Earth. So we're definitely on pins and needles. Meanwhile, as these regions rotate off of the Earth-facing disk, it looks like we'll finally see a little bit of a quiet period, and we'll get kind of a little bit of a respite for at least a few days before more regions begin to rotate into Earth view. Now, taking a closer look at the active regions on the Earth-facing disk, we switch to the HMI instrument aboard the SDO spacecraft that allows us to take a look at the magnetic complexity of these regions. Now, as you look at them, the more colors you see and the more mixing you see, that should be an eye-opener for you. So we have a lot of regions on the Earth-facing disk, but the real big ones, as you can see, are regions 2866 and regions 2868. These regions have been growing quite a bit over this past week, and their level of complexity has been varying a little bit. But I tell you, it's definitely making them big flare players. As a matter of fact, NOAA has given us about a 5% chance of an X-class flare with these regions, so we are watching them very carefully. Now, as you can see, most of these regions are going to be rotating off of the Earth-facing disk here in the next few days, probably 3 or 4 days, and so we'll see that solar flux drop a bit over the next week from probably the low 90s down into the maybe mid 80s or so. But until then, amateur radio operators and emergency responders expect that radio blackouts could be an issue for you, so stay vigilant. And then also expect over the next few days, at least for you amateur radio operators, to get kind of a bit of a fizzle when it comes to radio propagation on Earth's dayside. Switching to our M-flare threat meter, you can see the X-ray flux over the past week has not been too bad. We've been sitting a little bit above the B floor, and we have been popping some flares. We got some serious activity right around the 8th. That's when we popped nearly that M-class flare. That was from region 2864 when it launched that solar storm that's grazing Earth now. And as a matter of fact, by proxy, the solar flux has been increasing. In fact, during this period between about the 7th and the 10th, we actually had crested over 100 and made triple digits in the solar flux. So amateur radio operators and emergency responders, if you've been enjoying some decent radio propagation on Earth's dayside, that is the reason why. But meanwhile, things are beginning to calm down just a little bit. We're back into the 90s, and we could go and dip into about the mid 80s by the time all of these regions rotate off of the Earth-facing disk. And it definitely looks like we're going to see a bit of time elapse before we get some new bright regions rotate into Earth view. So it could be maybe over the next 4 or 5 days, things will continue to quiet down a bit, and we should get a respite from the risk of radio blackouts. Switching to our solar storm conditions, you can see over this past week we've had basically unsettled conditions and even quiet conditions, but we have had a couple sporadic instances of hitting active conditions. The first time was back on the 8th, and this was due to a glancing blow from a solar storm and maybe a pocket of fast solar wind. It was a little bit hard to tell. That managed to give us some beautiful aurora at high latitudes and even down into mid latitudes for a little while before things began to settle down. Then things kind of quieted down. And with that big solar storm that was launched off to the Earth's west from region 2864, well, it's been a glancing blow. And late on the 10th, it managed to bump us up to active conditions again. And we're kind of still kind of settling down from that. And that brought us yet another nice set of aurora, especially at high latitudes. But then things are once again beginning to settle down. And although we don't have any other storms in the forecast to really hit Earth, aurora photographers, definitely don't put your cameras away, because we do have maybe a glancing blow. And if that big filament erupts that we're looking at on the sun's disk right now, wow, we could be in for a nice show. So what else does our sun have in store for us this week? Well, this is Stereo A. It's our partially far-sighted monitor. You can see here's Earth, here's the sun, and here's Stereo A staring at the sun just a little bit from the side. And that's why the stereo view looks very much like Earth view anymore, and it's going to continue to look even more like Earth view as time goes on. You can see all the active regions kind of on the west limb, like moving off out of stereo's view. And you do see on the 8th that filament eruption, whoosh, kind of lifting off. That's the eruption that launched that solar storm that's likely going to go east of Earth, but we're most likely going to have it hit stereo. So we're watching out for that. But if you look to the east of that, you're really not seeing a lot of activity. You've got a couple regions in the south that are beginning to rotate into stereo's view right now. And there are some other solar storms being launched in the south that are just out of stereo's view. So we're kind of paying attention to see what's going to rotate in stereo's view in a few days. But meanwhile, what this means is that as all of those regions rotate off the Earth-facing disk, we definitely will have some quiet. We'll have solar flux drop down into the 80s, and that'll probably last at least 3 or 4 days before things begin to ramp back up with some of these new regions that we're beginning to see. Switching to our moon, we are now passing through the first quarter phase on our way to a full moon, and by the 16th, the moon will be about 75% illuminated. So you night sky watchers, if you want to catch those dim objects in the sky, you're going to have this bright companion to deal with, so you're going to need to check your local rise and set times. Switching to our solar storm conditions and aurora possibilities over the coming week, we are experiencing that glancing blow from one of those solar storms that was launched to the west of Earth. And we are also anticipating that other solar storm that should be going off to the east of Earth, but it could also give us a glancing blow. So at high latitudes, NOAA is expecting unsettled conditions, but we could have up to about a 25% chance of a major storm. And those chances will kind of settle down over the next couple days. At mid-latitude, we're also expecting unsettled conditions, but just in case we get that glancing blow, we could see as much as 15% chance of active conditions. So aurora photographers, definitely keep your cameras at the ready, because aurora could happen. And on top of that, as things begin to settle down throughout the week, just remember, these conditions could change very rapidly. If that filament that's passing through the Earth strike zone right now actually does erupt and becomes a solar storm, because it could very well be Earth directed. Switching to our solar flare and particle radiation storm outlook over the coming week, we have so many active regions on the Earth-facing disk right now that everything isn't in the green. Believe it or not, we actually do have a big flare risk right now. NOAA is giving us about a 20% chance of M-class flares over the next couple days, and about a 5% chance of X-class flares. So amateur radio operators, emergency responders, and GPS users know that we have a risk for radio blackouts on Earth's dayside, so remain vigilant. Now, we do have these regions, the mainly regions 2866 and 2868 that are the big flare players, and they will be rotating off of the Earth-facing disk here about midweek. So we'll see that flare risk kind of drop down as the week progresses. We'll also see the solar flux drop. We've got about the 90s, low 90s right now, but we could see it dip into about the mid-80s by midweek, or even a little bit later than that. And that solar flux at the lower level should persist probably for about the next week after that before things will begin to ramp back up again. So amateur radio operators and emergency responders, if you're noticing radio propagation on Earth's dayside is beginning to tank about midweek, understand that that's just the natural course of things. Now, meanwhile, because we're still climbing out of solar minimum, we're barely hanging on to the D2 minor range for cosmic ray flux. So you frequent flyers, and this does include air crew who fly over 800 hours annually and fly at high altitudes and high latitudes. You need to maintain vigilance when it comes to your radiation dose because you're in the moderate range, and this does include prenatal passengers. So please take this into consideration in your flight plans. So the space weather this week is definitely keeping us on our toes. We have a partially Earth-directed solar storm that's giving us a glancing blow right now to the west. We could have a glancing blow to the east, so we could be seeing a little bit of aurora. So aurora photographers, definitely keep your batteries charged. We also have a filament that's rotating in through the Earth strike zone that looks like it's about to launch, so we're also watching that, because if that does launch, it could definitely be an Earth-directed solar storm. So let's keep our fingers crossed for that. Now, on top of that, amateur radio operators and emergency responders, well, you've been enjoying some decent solar flux in the low 90s, but things are going to kind of die off just a little bit here over the next few days. And this is because a lot of those bright regions on the Earth-facing disk are rotating off to the sun's far side. So if you expect the amateur radio propagation to kind of fizzle just a little bit, it will return, I promise you. Just hang in there. Now, also GPS users, well, you know, we actually have a risk right now for radio blackouts due to a couple big flare players on the Earth-facing disk. So if you are anywhere near the dawn or the dusk terminator, or you happen to be on Earth's night side in case there's a little bit of aurora, you need to be very careful to make sure your GPS reception is not giving you trouble. I'm Tamitha Scove, the Space Weather Woman. Thank you for watching.